What's up guys, I'm Phoenix Master 1 and welcome back for some more Fire Emblem Heroes, and this is going to be my comprehensive analysis and review of the Ashen Wolves banner featuring Yuri, Constance, Happy, Balthus, and also Muspel. So I'll be going over a lot of the builds that you can run for them for different game modes like Arena, Aether Raids, and PvE. And if you do enjoy these in-depth reviews, then I would really appreciate if you could follow play that like and subscribe button just like Yuri. And with that said, let us begin. Yuri is a Gen 6 colorless dagger infantry unit with Honorable Blade as his preferred weapon. This gives him Kanto 2, which is really amazing for an infantry unit, and it also gives him minus 1 special cooldown, so he can easily use 2 turn specials like Glimmer, Ruptured Sky, and Moonbow and have them pre-charge at start of a turn. He also gets 1 extra movement at start of every turn, and this is gonna be permanent, so this basically makes Yuri into an honorary cavalry unit essentially, without any kind of disadvantage of a cavalry unit of having effective damage against them or being slowed down by trenches, while also enjoying Kanto and the infantry only skills like Null Follow Up and Time Pulse. His weapon can also give him plus 6 attack and speed during the combat if the foe is at or above half health. So this weapon is really offensive and allows for a lot of hit and run plays because he has got 3 movement, he has got Kanto built into his weapon, which means that his slot B is open to run some other skills, and he can be a really unique unit because of this. Having 3 movement is no joke, and he also gets access to foul play with that. So it makes him an extremely unique unit because this is a 3 range swap basically. So keep in mind that this is a forced 3 range swap, similar to how Physic is forced 2 range. So it can only work in 3 range and it will not work in 2 or 1 range. And it's not going to be that big of a problem with aggressive plays because you can basically just swap an ally out of the danger zone or even put them into the enemy's danger zone while also testing traps by using Disarm Trap and Slot B, especially for Aether Raids. But in general, he's going to be a very unique infantry dagger unit, having that 3 movement, having access to Kanto in his weapon, and also this unique assist skill in foul play. So it gives him really nice utility which no other infantry dagger unit has. Layla has similar thing with her dagger, but that has not aged the best I would say because of Farsave, and I used Layla a lot in Aether Raids. Yuri is basically like an upgraded Layla with foul play and having this kind of 3 movement, so you can have a lot of fun with him if you like player phase strategies. He also has C-Duel Infantry 4 as a slotted skill, and I've made a separate video going over the best options for it from the free to play as well as the premium pool. And then he's got Time Pulse, which is in my opinion the perfect slotsy skill for him because he can have a pre-charged 2-turn special with his Honorable Blade. So Glimmer is his default special and that is going to be pre-charged. Aside from his utility, Yuri is no slouch in combat either because he has got extremely high base speed of 43 while also having a super boon in it and also pretty nice 39 base attack. And I would say that even plus attack IV is not that bad even though he has got plus speed super boon. So it really depends on your playstyle, and if you want to secure more KOs on bulky units, then plus attack IV is not that bad even at low investment. And at higher investments he's going to be pretty fast, so plus attack IV could be opted, but it really depends if you want to outspeed more units or hit harder with your pre-charge special. His bulk isn't really all that special and he's really not meant to take a lot of hits. He's just meant to go in there, hit very hard, retreat back with Kanto, or just use foul play and put an enemy inside the range or outside the enemy range. A very unique thing about Yuri is that he is a dagger cavalier essentially, and he can also run Disarm Trap and Slot B without really requiring any kind of trace skill because Kanto is built into his weapon. For other dagger cavalry units, they have to choose between the trace skill or Disarm Trap for Aether Raids. Yuri can just go with Disarm Trap, or for other game modes he can just run Null Follow Up and still have really amazing mobility without really compromising on anything else. Yuri looks quite promising to me because of his unique utility with foul play and the Kanto built into his weapon. Usually, units with any kind of support capability or utility are going to be aging up much better than units who are just pure stats, and we see this time and time again. Even now, after so many years, Legend Lucina is not really that bad because of having Future Vision, which is unique to her, and Yuri is pretty much going to be similar to that with foul play and also his preferred weapon, which are opening up some really nice options. As for his builds, you can definitely go with Desperation as a budget skill on Slot B, or you could also go with the Link skill. A Link skill is going to be nice with foul play if you're going to be mainly using him for that support. And for Sacred Seal, you could definitely go with Attack Speed Solo because he's essentially a cavalry unit, so he's going to be away from his allies most of the time while entering combat, so a solo skill is not that bad. For Etherate's offense, Disarm Trap from the Divine Code section is basically gonna be his best lobby skill. Like I explained before, he doesn't really have to choose between a Trace skill or Disarm Trap like the other Dagger Cavaliers, and he also enjoys the infantry skills like Time Pulse, Sturdy Impact, and things of those nature, so I feel like Disarm Trap is really amazing. He can just test the traps while retreating with Kanto, and even just attack into the enemy, even if there are traps, and his firepower isn't really all that bad, even at unmerged, with Time Pulse and a pre-charged Moonbow. Moonbow is gonna be a bit better for Etherate's offense purpose, I feel like, because many times tanks can be really, really bulky, so Moonbow gives you a bit better throughput than Glimmer, in my opinion. And as it is, Noid is gonna be giving the extra defense in the light season, so that's why Moonbow is gonna be helping. The ideal skill is pretty nice because it works off the movement buff that he gets from his preferred weapon. That is going to be permanent, so he's always going to be having the plus 7 attack and speed. So ideal skill is pretty nice, but I can understand that it's not the easiest one to get. So attack speed solo or attack speed push 4 can be an option as well for an offensive Saudi option for Aether Raids. Yuri excels with player phase playstyles with hit and run and by also using utility of fall play. So with safety fence, you can essentially go in and retreat back with Kanto, and he's not really going to be caring about any kind of traps because of disarm trap. And then you can use the foul play utility to send an ally into the range of the enemy who can likely clean up or just initiate with gale force and try to sweep the opponent's team. And with multiple dancers, he can definitely be a pretty strong unit for that kind of playstyle. It's not like he's needed for this, he can still have a lot of hit and run playstyles, but Yuri can give you some unique options because of the disarm trap that he can run, and also while having Kanto. You can also use him in Etherate's defense, but I'm not the biggest fan of Kanto on Etherate's defense because it can often just waste your dances and stuff like that from my experience. So it's not the best unit for Etherate's defense, but he can still be a pretty nice unit because of the fact that he's got 3 movement, so he can work with a Node team. And you can basically use him with an impact skill so that he doesn't get doubled by malted or those kinds of guaranteed doubles. He's going to be pretty fast as it is, but Lull attack speed is going to be pretty nice for giving him some extra bulk. So with this kind of build, you basically want to stack up enough defense for him so that he can actually survive some hits. Precharge Moonbow is going to be giving you some nice throughput in terms of damage. AI unfortunately cannot really use foul play as an offensive tool. It can only use this as a defensive tool, so it kind of limits his potential, but still he's decent unit, pretty unique with the fact that he can have 3 movement and also run skills like Sturdy Impact, Time Pulse, and also Null Follow-Up, but a little skill can do the job. And for max investment, I feel like the best lobby skill for him outside of Etherate's offense is definitely gonna be Null Follow-Up. So you can run Sturdy Impact in Arena, especially if you have a maxed out Yuri. He doesn't really need a dual skill because after a first merge, he's gonna be hitting 180 BSD as it is. So yeah, it's kind of funny that he comes with a dual skill. You can run Sturdy Impact again because he has got the offenses from his dagger. We wanna stack up some defense on him so that he can actually survive some hits from the enemy units. So Sturdy Impact, I feel like, is extremely good for Arena, and he can have a pre-charged Ruptured Sky. And I cannot stress it enough that how amazing foul play is going to be in Arena for giving you that utility, for giving you some movement options, and the Kanto in his weapon is super, super amazing, especially when you're not stopped by trenches like all of the other cavalry units have. So Yuri is just going to be a fantastic option, and it's going to be making your life really easy in Arena if you do end up plus and merging him. Null Follow-Up can be pretty nice for bypassing those follow-up negation units, and because of having Ruptured Sky pre-charged, if anyone counter-attacks him and he can charge a special, then he can basically fire Ruptured Sky twice in a combat, and that can be pretty nice for securing KOs. Happy is a Blue Mage Cavalier with Demonic Tome as her preferred weapon, which gives her effective damage against Dragon and Beast units. This weapon also gives her minus 1 special cooldown, and on top of that, it also has Time Pulse built into it, which is extremely good because cavalry units do not have access to Time Pulse in their passives. So she can run 2 turn specials like Glimmer, Moonbow, Ruptured Sky, and have it pre-charged at start of every turn. And at start of combat, if she's got more than 25% HP, then she can get plus 6 attack and resistance during the combat. She has got insanely high attack stat at base 42 with a super boon in it, so obviously this is gonna be her preferred IV, and Happy's playstyle is really simple, which is to hit really hard, focus on one shots, and if she's gonna be failing to one shot the enemy, then most of the time she's gonna be dying herself because of her low speed and her low defense. So that's her playstyle. It's kinda similar to Legendary Lilina in a way, but instead of having the AoE special and hardy bearing which she has got, Happy has got the effective damage against Dragon and Beast units, and also has Time Pulse. So at start of every turn, she's going to be able to have a pre-charge special. So the effective damage is definitely going to be pretty relevant because of threats like Fallen Edelgard and Duo Idun, of course. And she can be a pretty fantastic unit in Aetherite's defense because of having this kind of pre-charge special. Even though we've got Zelina and Reinhardt, Happy is still pretty strong as a Blue Mage Cavalier because of her niche of having this kind of pre-charge special. So she's really straightforward as a nuke, and the effective damage definitely makes her a bit more unique in today's metagame. She's got Attack Res Catch, which is a new skill, and this is definitely her best slotted skill as it gives her the most amount of throughput on her attack. And Fault Trace is pretty nice as well for movement and for retreating after she has killed a foe. Glimmer, in my opinion, is pretty much going to be the best special for her as it is. The discussion between Glimmer versus Ruptured Sky is quite interesting, but from what I've calculated, Glimmer is basically going to be out damaging Ruptured Sky in most cases. The reason being is that Ruptured Sky requires the enemy to have attack stat, and it really requires the enemy to have a high attack stat. And most of the time, because of her effective damage against the beast and dragon units and also her naturally high attack stat, Glimmer is usually going to be giving you a better damage output. So if you're using her outside of arena, then Glimmer is fine, but in arena, of course, she likes to have Ruptured Sky because it's a high scoring special. Now let's go over her builds. For a budget build, you could run Resistance Mode, Goat Cavalry, Hone Cavalry, any kind of slotty skill. It's really flexible. She already comes with really good slotty and sloppy skill. And for Sacred Seal, you can definitely go with Death Blow, any kind of solo skill that can increase her attack stat. Simply go with her playstyle, which is of hitting really hard. If you want to invest a bit more into her, then I feel like Attack Res Menace is the best slotty skill for Happy. The reason being is that it happens before the combat, unlike the smoke skills whose debuffs happen after the combat. So Resistance Smoke gives you the attack buff and also debuffs the resistance of the opponent, which increases her one-shot potential, which is her playstyle. It is definitely a premium skill, but if you use Happy a lot, then this can definitely be worth it on her. As I said before, she functions really well in Aetherite's defense. You could of course use her in Aetherite's offense as well as a hit and run unit, but I feel like there are a lot more ranged cavalry units and cavalry units in general who can work with that playstyle much better. Happy shines a bit more in defense than she does in offense, in my opinion. And this is because of the fact that she can have a pre-charged Glimmer. So with a node team in the Dark Season, she can of course be a really big threat, and on a budget you can simply run any kind of slotty skill which can support your allies and have Deathblow as a Sacred Seal. If you're going to be using her with her Trace skill, then I highly recommend you to not run any kind of assist skill on Happy. The reason being is same as I said in Yuri's section, which is the fact that I'm not the biggest fan of Kanto on Aetherite's defense, because oftentimes it can just mess up your movement and waste your dances, so that's why just have her without any kind of assist skill. If you want to invest a bit more into her, then Lull Attack Resistance is much better than the Trace skill for Aetherite's defense scenario. The reason being is that you can ignore the buffs of the opponents, and people are going to be using Peony and stuff like that, so they're of course going to be having buffs, and Lull skill is going to be giving you much better results in my opinion. Blade Session can be run just to make it so that she can have the most amount of attack power. It's mainly used for the attack, not really so much for the speed. But speaking of speed, at max investment or at high investment, you can definitely go with ARD attack speed, wind sweep, and a menace skill. And you might think it's a bit convoluted to increase her speed, even though her playstyle just requires her to focus on her attack stat. And you'd be right, but there's the fact that you're going to be facing Palustin Brave Hectors, who are summoner supported, who have got support from Flayne. They're getting that damage reduction, and Happy, even at Palustin merge, is not going to be able to kill that kind of Hector. So if you're a Vault of Heaven player, especially if you'd like to hit tier 39 or you play in top 1k, because they're always going to be happening, every single week I face like one or two of them, guaranteed pretty much. So those kinds of Farsight Brave Hectors at max investments are a big problem, and you can just annoy them a bit more with Windsweep so that Happy doesn't die and she can still fire off her special. And her speed is going to be just more than enough to win the Windsweep check against most of the tanks, and this could also help you in the scenarios when you're going to be facing something like Farsight Brave Edelgard. So Happy doesn't really do the best against those kinds of units who are supported well by Flayne and stuff like that. Damage reduction can definitely be annoying for Happy's playstyle, and in players' hands, they're of course going to be using those kinds of tools. So at this level of investment, I feel like Windsweep build really pays off in the long run. And finally, if you have invested into her heavily at plus 10 merge, then she can be just a really, really amazing unit for Arena with B Dual Cavalry 4, so she can have Ruptured Sky pre-charged, and that gives you fantastic one-shot potential even against Pluston Merge Whale units. And that can be really amazing because you can have that delete button essentially with Happy, and Fortress is good as it is in Arena for that mobility. So nothing really too much to change here except for the Mana skill, which is going to be helping you getting those one shots. Constance is a Red Mage flyer with Agnes Arrow as her preferred weapon. So this gives her plus 3 speed, and if she initiates combat or if she's within 2 spaces of an ally, then she can get plus 6 attack and speed, and she has got partial null follow-up built into her weapon. So this weapon is always going to be active in the player phase, but in the enemy phase if you want to activate it, then she just needs to be within 2 spaces of an ally. Both of the conditions are super easy to meet. The secondary condition on her weapon actually depends on the turn. So on odd turns, she can basically neutralize the buffs on foe's speed and resistance, and on even turns, she neutralizes her own penalties on her attack and speed. So this can definitely help her with her damage output. I feel like the odd numbered effect is a bit helpful because flyers cannot have access to these kinds of lull skills and stuff like that. So Constance does have really amazing offenses, base 42 attack and base 40 speed. This is no joke, especially with the super boons in these two. Her bulk is nothing really too impressive. She's mainly going to be used in the player phase as an offensive unit. She can be compared to Duo Byleth, both of them are Red Mage flyers. On surface level, it might seem like she just blows out Duo Byleth out of the water, pun intended. But if you look a bit closer, then you'll realize that Byleth gets minus 1 special cooldown from her weapon. So she's pretty much going to be catching up to Happy's damage output by having a 2-turn special like Ruptured Sky, Moonbow, Glimmer. And she also has the duo skill, which is going to be really good. And because of the duo skill, she can score higher than Constance and also not have to occupy her slotted skill with a dual skill. So overall, I feel like Constance can be like a side grade to Byleth. I wouldn't really say that she's much better than Byleth or anything like that. Both of these are pretty fantastic Red Mage flyer options. It's just that Constance has got much easier effect to trigger with her weapon compared to Byleth, I would say. But still, Byleth's minus 1 special cooldown is really amazing for the overall damage output. And Constance can be summoned in the normal summoning pool, and she's going to be permanently there, while Byleth is a lot harder to get. Not to mention, you can also spark for Constance. Constance has got pretty amazing base kit, having anything that an offensive mage flyer can want, which is a push skill, a Fortress skill, and also a rain skill. So you don't really have to invest too heavily into Constance to have some good builds. So the first build is a budget build. You can just slap something like Reposition and Glimmer and have a Sacred Shield that can boost her offenses, and you're pretty much done. However, in my opinion, she functions much better with Windsweep than she does with Fortress. Because the problem with Fortress is that her bulk isn't really all that high, and in the event where she's not going to be one-shotting an opponent, she'll have to take some kind of counterattack back in many situations. Windsweep pretty much eliminates that and also makes use of the partial null follow-up built into her weapon. So because of the partial null follow-up, she can just negate any kind of follow-up negation skills of units, and that includes her Windsweep as well. So she can double attack while also not getting counterattack with Windsweep, and that's pretty similar to what Duo Byleth does, I guess. But yeah, Constance can also be really good in that role with this slot B skill. So I would definitely recommend that, and you can easily obtain this from the Grail pool. Blade Session is going to be further helping her in the player phase with her offensive potential. And at higher investments, you can definitely invest into her with a cat skill because you're not going to be taking any kind of recall damage. So Sparrow is also an option if you really dislike the recall damage of the push skill, but overall cat skill can give you the most amount of throughput on her offensive capability. Competitively, Constance has got a bit more use in Aetherite's defense than she does in offense, I feel like. And this kind of red color with Windsweep allows her to definitely be an annoyance for many units because of her high speed and the fact that she can also hit pretty hard with her attack stat. So the odd and even turns, especially when left in the AI's hands, are completely going to be at the mercy of the enemy when they're going to be attacking. And you can mainly use her with some kind of movement shenanigans, Sacred Seal, which can help her teleport and just be a bit more annoying to the opponent. And many fast tanks are not going to like to face her because of the Windsweep. And at max investment or high investment, ARD attack speed 4 can give her insane amounts of offensive potential, which is really consistent. And finally, in Arena, Constance is going to be amazing. I guess you can use the Fortress skill as well, but like I said before, in an event where she has to take a counter attack, that is not favorable because of her low defense. So Windsweep works out pretty fine, similar to Duo Byleth. She does have to use R-Dual Flying 4 in her slot A, So that sucks a bit when you compare her to Duo Byleth, but still she can just function pretty amazingly well as an offensive option. And you can also run some guidance skill or any kind of movement skills to help you out if you don't really want to run Blade Session. And Rupture Sky is basically going to be her best special option. I feel like at low investment, Constance likes to have plus speed IV, and at max investment I feel like she's going to be fast enough. So because of not having a weapon similar to Duo Byleth and requiring speed, she can just let go of plus speed IV and go with plus attack IV to have better damage output. So at max investment I feel like plus attack works fine, but at low investment plus speed is going to be helping you with the Windsweep build. Baltus is actually an instant demote unit from this banner, and he's going to be present in the 3-star 4-star pool. And just like the instant demote, he has got instant axe plus as his weapon. He doesn't have any kind of preferred weapon, no gauntlets this time, and this axe basically has a mini sturdy impact built into it. And this is not the ideal weapon for Baltus in my opinion, because he likes to have more enemy phase builds, which I'll go over of course. And he has got brazen attack defense at 4-star and close guard at 5-star, so nothing really too unique as fodder either. Brazen attack was already present on Ares. His stat spread is basically of a modern Kallik by having pretty high attack stat and good mixed bulk. He also has a super boon in speed and also the attack stat of course, but I feel like investing into his speed is a bit of a lost cause because of being already so slow. So I feel like plus attack IV is basically the best one. And it's worth noting that because of having 181 BST, he can reach 185 BST after the first merge with the plus attack IV, which can help you score really well in arena. So of course, like I said, he's pretty much like a modern Kallik, and Kallik is a one gen older unit. If you compare both of these at max investment, they're pretty similar except for the fact that Kallik is going to be having 3 more resistance, while Baltus is going to be having 5 extra defense and a bit lower speed. So these are pretty similar. Kallik just takes the grills, Baltus requires you to summon, and it can take you many months of trying to summon Baltus because the summoning pool is really bloated. On the other hand, if you have Heroic Grills, then you can just get Kallik. Of course, Heroic Grill is a pretty valuable currency as well, so it really depends on player to player if they want to spend their grills or if they want to spend their orbs. Of course, if you have a favorite between these two, then you should of course go with them, but keep in mind that Baltus undeniably has better scoring than Kallik because of his BST. So that's one of the things which Baltus just beats Kallik at pretty decisively in my opinion. And having this kind of high scoring unit is going to be helping you in future as well for arena in general. So that can be an option. And for his builds, I feel like on a budget you can just keep instant axe, and everyone does get a free 5-star copy of Baltus, so we can just use him in arena assault with Lancebreaker and stuff like that. Just make him a cheap budget unit for counter picks, and you can also use him with Dex Swapper. It's a really good weapon for a unit like him because especially on budget you don't really have to run a lull skill because it's built into the weapon, and you can just run quicker post and utilize Steady Breath. Steady Breath basically is going to be a staple on Baltus builds because you can have it available and use high cooldown specials like Ignis pretty easily with scale off his high defense stat. So this could be done on a budget, and at max investment or high investment I would definitely recommend going with Distant Counter to make full use of his mixed bulk, because his resistance is definitely not that bad and he can certainly use that with a Distant Counter build. And Dex Swapper of course is going to be a pretty fantastic option with Steady Breath Sacred Seal, and he can easily use a high cooldown special like Aether. Plagian Axe is also a pretty fantastic option for tanking, and you'll have to run lull attack defense if you want to have that in slot B. And Quick Riposte is going to be needed because Baltus doesn't really have any ways of doubling outside of it in the enemy phase. Plagian Axe requires him to have some kind of debuffing skill in slot C like Attack Smoke or Attack Defense Menace, whichever one is easier for you to get. Of course Attack Smoke is at least going to be required here, and he can of course be used in arena. His main use is going to be competitively in the arena game mode as a high scoring unit in the normal summoning pool with 185 BST. So this is pretty much the build I would say is ideal on Baltus because he can have Dex Swapper get the lull effect, which is extremely good in arena because everyone and their mom runs some kind of rally skill, and he will not have to sacrifice his slot B skill for that. You can just run Quick Riposte and have Steady Breath, and with this and Ruptured Sky you can basically retaliate back with Ruptured Sky and even trigger 2 Ruptured Skies if the enemy doesn't die in the first hit. So it gives him a pretty nice one shot potential with his high attack stat with the plus attack IV. I feel like this is a bit better way of using him than investing into a huge fan build, which functionally can do the same thing, but he's mostly gonna be used in the enemy phase, and the loud skill built into Deck Swapper can be extremely helpful in arena. So you can use this kind of build in arena for sure at max investment, and Plagian Axe is also an option. Because he doesn't have a preferred weapon, you have to run a 300 SP slotsy skill like Joint Drive Attack or Attack Defense Menace, in case of using Plagian Axe of course. As I said before, I don't think investing into his speed is really gonna be that worth it. I feel like going with plus attack IV is gonna be better, even at max investment builds, because his speed is not the highest. And if you're thinking of running some kind of spurn build or anything like that, I personally wouldn't really recommend that kind of thing. It's much better to just invest into his attack stat. For Aetheraids, he can be used as a unit who can support a Farsafe unit, so he can basically be on the front line and then be backed up by a Farsafe unit who can deal with the ranged units. So his matchup against Nova is of course going to be pretty insanely good, being a green unit with high defense, and you can basically run a sturdy stance and steady breath build with Ignis so that he can have a high damage output and be really bulky on the defensive side to deal with a lot of the melee threats. Muspel is a red dragon cavalry unit with Flame Lake Breath as his preferred weapon. So this weapon gives him plus 5 to all of his stats if he's above 25% HP, and then he has got a better Fatal Smoke built into this weapon. The reason why I say that it is better is because with Fatal Smoke, to apply the Deep Wounds effect, you need to survive the combat. However, with Flame Lake Breath, even if Muspel dies, he can still apply the status effect if he just attacked. So that is why I feel like it is a bit better than Fatal Smoke, because of its consistency, of the fact that he just has to hit you once, and his stat spread is gonna be pretty interesting with having really low speed and pretty nice mixed bulk and high attack stat at base 41. He does have Super Boon in both attack and defense. So yeah, I feel like being a Cavalier kinda hurts him than it helps him in my opinion, because oftentimes he's gonna be outside of the range of his Domain of Flame if he just goes up ahead of his allies. The BST penalty is there for Cavaliers, so he would like more stats in general as a tank if he were to be an infantry unit or even a armor unit or something like that. And also the fact that being a cavalry unit pretty much deprives you of many defensive skill options. But regardless, he has got this kind of Domain of Flame as his preferred skill, kind of similar to Domain of Ice of Nifl. However, this skill, in my opinion, is a bit more unique than Nifl's, because Nifl gives damage reduction and Flame also gives damage reduction. So it of course has Joint Drive Attack and Joint Drive Defense built into it, and it also has this kind of Joint Drive True Damage. So it basically compares the attack stat of the unit with the resistance of the opponent, and depending on the difference, it deals 30% of the damage of that. So it can give you true damage easily up to like 8 to 12 points of true damage, which is pretty amazing. So this is extremely unique for supporting his allies, and I feel like he's much better as a support unit than he's as a tank himself, because he doesn't really have any kind of auto follow up to secure KOs in the player phase or even do that in the enemy phase. He has to rely on quick repose to even double in the enemy phase, so that can be a bit problematic at times for a tank. But Dragon Wall is going to be making him pretty bulky with his resistance stat, and he of course gets the extra stats from his weapon. So for his builds, I feel like on a budget, of course ERD defense rest is not going to be helping you outside of Aetheraids, so you can go with Sturdy Stance and simply have Cook Riposte with Bonfire. You pretty much have to run him in enemy phase because of his stat spread. And you can also use him with Distant Counter if you want to invest a bit more into him, because he has that kind of bulk, and he also has the damage reduction with Dragon Wall with his high resistance. And you can also run him with Attack Defense Catch if you don't really want to run Distant Counter but still want a skill that can function in both phases. Of course, Attack Defense Solo is also an option, but Attack Defense Catch is a lot easier to trigger and doesn't really have the movement restriction, and Bonfire of course is going to be a staple on any kind of his build. He of course wants the attack super boon so that he can get more out of Domain of Flame and get more true damage. And competitively, he's mostly going to be used as a support unit. I feel like he's going to be a bit better in the light season than he's going to be in the anima season as a support. And the reason being is that in the anima season, people are going to be using Mirabilis, who can boost the resistance of the allies. And sometimes in higher echelons of Aetheraids in Vault of Heaven, people also use double, so that is plus 10 defense on the enemy's team. And that is not too good with Domain of Flame, which requires the enemy to ideally have lower resistance. So that's why I feel like Light Season is going to be his home, because people are mostly going to be using Note and Triandra and stuff like that. And you can pretty much run him with this kind of support build with Shove, a link skill that can ideally boost the attack stat and drive attack. So this is pretty much to make sure that your tank can do more damage. He can of course be used with far save, near save units to give them better damage output, so they themselves can focus on increasing their bulk, and then Muspel can basically provide them with this kind of extra damage output so that they can secure KOs. And ideally you want to have this with units who can retaliate back with a special so that they can just have that much, much better one shot potential along with the true damage that he's going to be giving them. At high investments, I feel like Fodra's defense res is helpful. I know it sounds a bit crazy with his attack stat being a requirement for Domain of Flame, but here he's mostly going to be used as a support unit, not really meant to go into combat himself much. So that's why Fodra's defense res is going to be helpful, so that he can soak the dark shrines, which is really going to be helpful for your tank, and the bright shrine can be soaked up by Uller, Dagger, stuff like that. And a Rue skill with rally attack speed plus from the Divine Code section is going to be really nice, because you're going to be debuffing the resistance of the opponent, and that gives you more true damage with Domain of Flame while also boosting the attack stat of your ally. So of course this is a way of doing it if you're going to be investing into him a bit more. He can also be used in Aetherite's defense, because Fatal Smoke is not to be underestimated, and his bulk is also really nice. Of course, the problem is that you don't want him to run up ahead of your entire team and just, you know, damage the opponent, because you're not going to be able to get the Domain of Flame advantage, and you want the allies to also just enjoy the Domain of Flame to get extra true damage. So that's why I feel like the Dark Season with Noid is not going to be his best spot. I feel like he works a bit better in the Anima Season. There are a couple of reasons for this. The first one is that people are not going to be running Dagger Air in Anima, but a lot of them are going to be running that in the Dark Season. And in the Anima Season, people are going to be using Ashera, but at least it's not like plus 10 resistance, which they get from Air and Dagger in the Light Season. And there's also the fact that you're going to be using Seros or Duma, who can increase the attack stat of your allies, so that just helps with Domain of Flame, of course. So he can work pretty nice in the Anima Season, and ideally you want to pair him up with Bright Catria or Far Save, Near Save tanks, or both of them actually, because the entire playstyle of a Catria ball team or a Far Save, Near Save armor unit team is basically going to be to discourage sniping, and it's going to be forcing the opponent to tank your team. And when they're going to be trying to tank your team, it is going to be really hard because of the true damage that Muspel is going to be giving his allies. And because of the Order's buff from Bright Catria, he can stay near his allies, so I feel like this is pretty much the best way of utilizing him, and I can actually make him really scary, because it kind of just deals with one of his issues of not having follow-up in the player phase, because Catria can provide you with a Brave effect, which is extremely annoying. And in general, you want to use him with the Rally skill in Arena so that he can come in front of your team to provide you the Domain of Flame. So Rally Trap is going to be his ideal usage with his default Rally Up skill, which is really good. And you can run Escutcheon with Quicken Pulse so that you can make it so that he can survive. Of course, even if he dies, he can still inflict the Fatal Smoke, but you still want him to survive to make it a bit more annoying for the enemy, because he can enjoy Domain of Flame. So that is pretty much my analysis on him, of how to use him in the Aether Raids, essentially in both offense and defense. He's certainly a pretty unique unit, but he's not someone who you must need, in my opinion, because you can still get consistency out of different support units in both offense and defense. But still, with the true damage that he provides, it's a bit more unique. Muspel can also be used in Arena with R Dual Cavalry 4, so of course this is not going to be needed super hard, unless you want to score absolute maximum, because it can increase your team score by 2 points, but still, make sure to check the Arena Calculator linked in the description before we commit to this. So because of being a Cavalry Dragon, he doesn't have access to Ruptured Sky, and of course no Gale Force for him. So Blue Flame is pretty much his best option by staying near his allies, and Domain of Flame can be pretty nice in Arena for dealing with a lot of those Whale plus 10 merge units. So I hope you all enjoyed this banner review. Make sure to share this video with your friends if they are building up any of these units. I went in depth and went over a lot of builds. And if you enjoyed, then make sure to leave a like and a comment, helps me tremendously. And if you really, really enjoyed it, then you can support me directly by using Super Thanks or by becoming a YouTube member down below. And I want to thank all of my YouTube members for the constant support. For more Fae analysis videos, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell, because YouTube sub boxes are about as functional as your healing after Fatal Smoke. So with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Thank you so much for watching and have a great day.